Hi students, all of you, good morning. Welcome to the class. In this class, we are going to revise few more topics from chemistry in everyday life. And there is a note on the board. Just once read the note. Practice the MCQs in your material and to know about the unknown medical terminologies. Just in the Chrome, Google Chrome, simply you can type it and you can Google it. There you can find the Wikipedia as well as images regarding of your unknown medical terminologies from this chapter. So thank you. Coming to today's class. Yes, on the screen you can see now. Yes, on the screen you are seeing. Today's topic is about cleansing agents. Cleansing means simply to remove the impurities or to clean what we are using, soaps and detergents in general. So here cleansing agents, soaps and detergents are the examples of cleansing agents. Yes, here we are seeing detergents. Two types of detergents are used as cleansing agents. These are soaps and synthetic detergents. Generally we know soap is different from detergent, but here the concept given as the detergents are classified into two types, soaps and synthetic detergents. These detergents are used to improve the cleansing properties of water. This is the main key point. The cleansing agents are used to improve the cleansing nature of water or cleansing properties of water, right? These help in removal of fats which bind other materials to the fabrics or skin. For example, when we are moving in sunlight, suppose at the noon, at the mid of the noon, then our skin becomes oily and our skin becomes dirty. So oil is nothing but that is a form of fat. So fat is going to be formed on the surface of the skin. And the dust is going to be absorbed on the surface of the fabrics. So to remove the dust from the surface of the fabrics and to remove the excess fats, that is oils, from the surface of the skin, we are using the cleansing agents. They are classified into two types, soaps and synthetic detergents. Yes, first coming to the soaps. In the surface chemistry chapter, you studied about the cleansing action of soap. What is meant by soap? What is meant by soap? C17H35COONA. In the chapter surface chemistry, you studied about the soap. C17H35COONA. See here, C17H35COONA. This is the soap. So here it is known as sodium stearate. So what are soaps means? Sodium salts of stearic acid. What are soaps? Sodium salts of stearic acid are the soaps. How the soaps are obtained? How the soaps are manufactured? To manufacture the soap, we are using glyceryl ester of stearic acid, that is the fat. When it is reacting with the sodium hydroxide, as acid is reacting with a base. When an acid is reacting with a base, that reaction is said to be a neutral reaction, neutralization reaction. So here we are getting the salt, that is the sodium stearate, right? Soaps are the detergents used since long. Soaps used for cleaning purpose are sodium or potassium salts of long chain fatty acids. Soaps are the sodium or potassium salts of long chain fatty acids. For example, already we said that soap is a sodium salt of stearic acid. Once again, soap is a sodium salt of stearic acid. Of course, we can also take sodium or potassium salts of oleic acid, or sodium or potassium salts of palmitic acids. Sodium or potassium salts of stearic acid. All these are the sodium or potassium salts of long chain fatty acids. They are known as soaps. Soaps containing sodium salts are formed by heating the fat. See here, what is heated? Fat is heated in the presence of a base, aqueous sodium hydroxide solution. This reaction is known as saponification. Preparation of soaps is called as saponification. Yes, this is the reaction important for PU level, but this chapter is completely removed for the PU. So no need to remember all the reactions from this chapter. Just simply remember the concept and their examples. So what is meant by saponification? The preparation of soaps by heating the fat with aqueous solutions of sodium hydroxide is called as saponification. What are meant by soaps means? Soaps are the sodium or potassium salts of long chain fatty acids like stearic acid or oleic acid or palmitic acid. Yes, just simply you can remember this formula. The example for the soap is C17H35COONA. It is the sodium salt of stearic acid. In the crossing MCQs, that is one side ABCD will be given and the other side Roman number 1, 2, 3, 4 will be given. That is matching the following, match the following. When the match the following type of questions are given, this type of concepts will be asked. So try to remember the formula of the salt is sodium stearate is an example of the formula of the formula of the soap. The formula of the soap that is sodium stearate C17H35COONA, right? The preparation of soaps is called as saponification. Yes, coming to the classification of soaps, how many types of soaps are there? Basically, all soaps are made by boiling the fats or oils with suitable and soluble hydroxide. And variations are made by using different raw materials. Soaps are classified on the basis of their different raw materials from which they are going to be synthesized. One is the toilet soaps. Toilet soaps are prepared by using better graded of fats and oils, and care is taken to remove excess alkali. Yes, all of you know, in the saponification process, we are using aqueous sodium hydroxide solution. Sodium hydroxide solution is basic, that is alkaline in nature. If excess alkali is there, again, the skin becomes alkali. So in the manufacturing of toilet soaps, that is the bathing soaps, toilet soaps are nothing but bathing soaps. In the manufacturing of bathing soaps, we have to remove the excess alkali. Excess care is taken to remove the excess alkali. And we know the toilet soaps, bathing soaps are having different colors, different flavors, different perfume scents. So colors and perfumes are added to make these more attractive. So that is about toilet soaps. Next, soaps that float in water are made by beating tiny air bubbles before their hardening. So generally, if you touch the soap, generally we will feel a little bit hard it is. So before making the soap hard, some tiny means very small, tiny air bubbles are entered into that soaps. Transparent soaps are made by dissolving the soap in ethanol and then evaporating the excess solvent. Transparent soaps. If you go for the luxury soaps, for example, Pierce soap, that is, if you say that Pierce soap, that will appear like a transparent soap. So transparent soaps are made by dissolving in ethanol and then evaporating the excess solvent. Next one, medicated soaps. For skin allergies, for skin problems, we are using the medicated soaps. Medicated soaps are the substances of medical values or medicinal values. Some soaps and deodorants are added. Shaving soaps. Shaving soaps means shaving creams. The shaving soaps, here you can see, the transparent soaps are made by dissolving. Okay, fine. And it is about medicated soaps. In the medicated soaps, the medicinal values are added. In some soaps, deodorants are added. Shaving soaps contain glycerol. What is the formula of glycerol? CH2 single bond OH, single bond CH, single bond OH, single bond CH2 single bond OH, right? So glycerol is added to prevent the rapid drying. Generally, some person's skin is very dry. That means moisture from the skin is going to be removed easily, evaporated easily. So to make the skin moistured, we are using the shaving soaps that is containing glycerol. So glycerol is going to stop the evaporation of moisture from the surface of the skin. A gum called rosin is added while making them. It forms sodium rosinate, which lathers well. It forms the lather. Lather means a foam. And Landry soaps. Landry soaps means the soaps which are used for washing the clothes. The Landry soaps containing fillers like sodium rosinate, sodium silicate, borax, sodium carbonate. Yes, see this one, borax. What is the formula of borax? In the first POC, you studied about the borax. Yes, once you check that material about what is the formula of borax, you have to text me the formula of the borax. Right, coming to the next one. Soap chips are made by running a thin sheet of melted soap onto a cool cylinder and scraping off the soap in small broken pieces. And soap granules are dried miniature soap bubbles. Soap powders and scouring soaps containing some soap and scouring agent like abrasive such as powdered fumes are finely divided sand and builders like sodium carbonate and trisodium phosphates. So the soap chips are going to contain powdered fumes or finely divided sand or builders like sodium carbonate or trisodium phosphate. Builders make the soap act more rapidly. Yes, this is about different types of soaps. And already in the surface chemistry chapter, we studied about cleansing action of soap. Once again, go through the surface chemistry to know about the cleansing action of soap, right? So here also it is given. Some reaction is given about soap. When soap is going to be dissolved in hard water. What the hard water contains? Hard water contains salts of calcium and magnesium. Again, this is studied in the first POC. Hydrogen, the chapter hydrogen, you studied about water. Water is classified into two types, soft water and hard water. What is meant by soft water? The water sample which gives lather readily with soap. Once again, what is meant by soft water? The water sample which readily gives lather with soap is called as soft water. What is meant by hard water? The water sample which does not give lather readily with soap, that is called as hard water. Why water becomes hard? Because of the dissolved salts of calcium and magnesium, the water becomes hard. So whenever some sample of hard water is taken, when the soap is going to be dissolved, then calcium ions or magnesium ions of hard water are going to be exchanged with sodium ions of soap. Here is the exchange reaction is given. See this one. This is an example of metal-metal exchange reaction. In the first PSC, you studied about exchange reactions. Metal-metal exchange reaction, metal-non-metal exchange reactions like that. This is an example of metal-metal exchange reaction. We are taking the soap here, C17H35COONA. This is containing the metal sodium. When it is going to react with hard water, the hard water containing the calcium salts, here calcium is the metal. Calcium metal is going to be replaced with or displaced with sodium. Then we are going to get 2 moles of sodium chloride in aqueous solution. 2 moles of sodium chloride in aqueous solution. That means in the water, now there is no calcium ions. In the water, there is no calcium ions. Now there is the presence of sodium ions. Now the hardness of water is going to be removed, right? And we can see the formation of a precipitate. What is the precipitate formed here? Insoluble precipitate, that is insoluble calcium stearate, is going to be formed as a precipitate. Yes, you have to remember this formula, insoluble calcium stearate. Soap is going to be precipitated in the form of C17H35CO taken twice CA. Suppose when we are doing our bath with hard water, but not with soft water. Once again, when we are doing the bathing with hard water, but not with soft water, when we apply the water on the skin and when we are going to use the soap on the body, we can see some precipitations of the soap. So what is the precipitation of that soap? C17H35COO taken twice CA. If the hard water is containing calcium ions, then we will get the precipitation C17H35COO taken twice CA. Suppose if the hard water is containing dissolved salts of magnesium but not calcium, then what is the precipitate we are going to get on our body when we are going to use hard water for bathing and when we are going to apply the soap and the hard water is going to contain the magnesium ions but not calcium ions? What will be the precipitation going to be formed on our skin? Yes, you have to text this answer also if you are watching this video. Right, coming to the next point. The insoluble soaps separate as scum. Of course, I am saying precipitate, nothing but scum. Scum in water and are useless as cleansing agents. So this is useless. This is not a cleansing agent because it is not containing sodium salt. So what is the cleansing agent? This is the cleansing agent. C17H35CO Na is the cleansing agent, but not C17H35CO taken by CA. What is cleansing agent? Soaps and synthetic detergents are the cleansing agents. They are the sodium or potassium salts of stearic acid. See here, sodium or potassium salts of stearic acid or oleic acid or palmitic acid. So soap is going to contain either sodium ions or potassium ions only. That is going to have cleansing action. So here the scum is formed. This is the scum formed. This scum is not going to have any cleansing action because it is not having the sodium ions. So that is about the paragraph given here. Please read it. You can understand. Next topic is synthetic detergents. Synthetic detergents are cleansing agents which have all the properties of soaps. So detergents, synthetic detergents are also acting as soaps, but which actually do not contain any soap. The synthetic detergents are not containing the soap, still they are acting like soaps. These can be used both in soft and hard water as they give foam even in the hard water. So this is the main use of synthetic detergents. So the synthetic detergents can be used to form the froth. That's why we are using so many synthetic detergents like Surf Excel or Rin. So many detergents are there. They can give froth with soft water as well as hard water. So that's why to clean the fabrics, to wash the fabrics, we are not using the soaps. To wash the fabrics, we are using synthetic detergents like Ariel, Rin, something, right? So synthetic detergents, they are not containing the soap, still they are having the cleansing action of soap. How and why? Synthetic detergents are mainly classified into three categories. First one, anionic detergents. Second one, cationic detergents. Third one, non-ionic detergents. This is the most important topic for CET, NEET and JEE. Most important topic. What are the classifications of synthetic detergents? Three, anionic detergents, cationic detergents and non-ionic detergents. First, coming to anionic detergents. Anionic detergents are sodium salts of sulfonated long chain alcohols or hydrocarbons. Yes, this is the main key point you have to remember. Anionic detergents are sodium salts of sulfonated long chain alcohols or hydrocarbons. Yes, see this one. This is the long chain sulfonate containing salt, sodium salt. So the formula is given as CH3, CH2 taken 10 times, CH2 OSO3 minus Na+. This is a sodium Lauryl sulfate, very, very, very important one. Sodium lauryl sulfate formula, CH3, CH2 taken 10 times, CH2, OSO3 minus Na plus, sodium lauryl sulfate. Yes, here, this part, that is the hydrocarbon part, is containing negative charge. This type of synthetic detergent is called as anionic detergent. Sodium lauryl sulfate is an example of anionic detergent, right? And one more example is given here. Sodium dodecyl benzene sulfonate. Sodium dodecyl benzene sulfonate. Again, say this organic part. This organic part is containing negative charge, right? So this is an example of anionic detergent. So simply you can remember sodium lauryl sulfate and sodium dodecyl benzene sulfonate are the examples of anionic detergents. And what is the use of anionic detergents? Yes, here you can see in anionic detergents, the anionic part of the molecule is involved in the cleansing action. Sodium salts of alkyl benzene sulfonates are important class of anionic detergents. They are mostly used for household work. Anionic detergents are also used in toothpaste. Yes, in the morning itself, every day, we are using the toothpaste. So toothpaste is containing anionic detergents. Remember this one? Toothpastes are containing anionic detergents. The examples for anionic detergents are sodium lauryl sulfate and sodium dodecyl benzene sulfonate. They are used in household work and they are used in toothpaste. Yes, coming to the second category, cationic detergents. Cationic detergents are quaternary ammonium salts of amines. Quaternary ammonium salts of amines with acetates, chlorides or bromides as anions. As anions. So what is the anion part? Acetate ion may be the anion part, chloride ion may be the anion part, or bromide ion may be the anion part. See this example. Here, which one is the anion part? Bromide is the anion part. Here, bromide may be there, or chloride may be there, or acetate may be there. But if you see the organic part here, this organic part is containing which charge? Positive charge. So when organic part is containing positive charge, and that is going to be bonded with either acetates, chlorides, or bromides, which type of salts they should be? Quaternary ammonium salts of amines. Then such salts are called as cationic detergents. So cationic detergents are containing quaternary ammonium salts of amines. Say this one, nitrogen. Nitrogen is having four bonds here. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this nitrogen is said to be as quaternary ammonium salt. This salt is said to be as quaternary ammonium salt. In the case of quaternary ammonium salts, that part is always going to contain positive charge because nitrogen should contain only three bonds. Whenever nitrogen is containing four bonds, such nitrogen is said to be positively charged. And that nitrogen is quaternary ammonium salt. That nitrogen is forming quaternary ammonium salt. This is a quaternary ammonium salt containing positive charge bonding with bromide ion. And the name of this compound is, cetyl trimethyl, ammonium bromide. Cetyl trimethyl ammonium bromide. This is an example of cationic detergent. Yes, what is the use of cationic detergent? The cationic detergents have germicidal properties. Very important one. Germicidal properties to kill the bacteria, to kill the microbes. That is germicidal property. Cationic detergents have germicidal property and are expensive. Therefore, these are of limited use. So to avoid the skin diseases, to stop the skin diseases, to stop the skin allergies, the germicidal property containing creams are used, or the germicidal properties containing soaps are used, synthetic detergents are used. So cetyl trimethyl ammonium bromide is an example of cationic detergent. Simply you can understand, the organic part is going to contain positive charge bonded with either bromide or chloride or acetate. Yes. And coming to the last one, non-ionic detergent. Non-ionic means the total compound is not going to contain any positive charge or negative charge. It is neutral. It is not having cationic part or anionic part. It is completely a molecule neutral. Yes, see here. Non-ionic detergents do not contain any ion in their constitution. Whereas here, this is a cationic part. This is anionic part. Whereas in the non-ionic detergents, they do not contain any ion in their constitution. One such detergent is formed when stearic acids react with polyethylene glycols. When stearic acid reacts with polyethylene glycols, then we are getting the non-ionic detergents. They are neutral. They does not contain any ionic part. So this is a compound, an example for non-ionic detergent. And no name is given here. Liquid dishwashing detergents. Liquid dishwashing detergents are the examples of non-ionic detergents. In our house, we are using the liquid dishwash bars. Liquid dishwash bars, they are the examples of non-ionic detergents, right? So this is about soaps and synthetic detergents. Yes, you can read this paragraph, you can understand the concept. And index questions are given. In each and every chapter, index questions are given. For those index questions, at the end of the chapter, answers are provided. And if you go to the NCERT site website, there you can find the solutions for the index questions also. So please try to download the answers for the index questions. Try to read and understand. Most of the topics for NEET will be covered only from the NCERT textbook. But for the JEE, you have to follow NCERT textbook as well as other authored materials. Right? Thank you one and all. Yes, is there any other topic? You will get it out. There is no topic further. So simply summary is given. And my dear student, for every chapter at the end, in the textbook at the end, summary is given. If you read that summary for 10 minutes or for 15 minutes, having some concentration, you can understand the total chapter easily. In a simple manner, you can understand the topic easily. So try to read the summary of every chapter and then go for the exercise problems. At the end of the chapter, exercise problems are given or exercise questions are given. Try to solve all these. That's enough to get the best rank in the NEET as well as in the JEE. Of course, if you can do this one, simply you will get the best rank for a KSET also. Thank you one and all. Please have some patience while watching the video lectures. And then practice the MCQs from your material. Thank you one and all. Stay home, stay safe. This is your chemistry lectures. Sridhar Naidu signing off. Have a nice day.